Looking to improve your life, brush up on your personal growth techniques? You are in the right place. Welcome to Life's Little Lessons with your host, author of Designing Your Own Destiny, Kevin A. Dunlap.
Hello, everybody. This is Kevin Dunlap with Life's Little Lessons, and welcome back to our show. Today, I have this lovely lady. I've known her for a few years. We're constantly running across each other. She was a lady that I actually, when I wrote my book, Designing Your Own Destiny, I wanted a testimony from her, and she's one of the two people that made the back cover. The
other one
Yay! And Jen Lucas was the other one, and her show is either right before this one or right after this one. So both people that made the back cover are going to be back to back on this
podcast. Oh, cool. Series.
And speaking of books, this is a lady that also wrote a book called Shrink, and it was, well, we are recording this episode just a couple of days after she had her book launch, and she actually hit the Amazon bestseller list, I believe in three different categories, and she'll tell us more about that here in just a moment. This is a lady that's also a clinical psychologist. She's an NLP practitioner. Obviously, she's an author. She's a speaker, and she has great information that she's going to be sharing with us today. Her name is Daphne Earhart. She's in California. For those of you that are actually watching the video version of this show, you see a beautiful Pacific Ocean right over her shoulders, some beautiful beaches. And here we are. And then, so without any further ado, I want to introduce Daphne Earhart. Daphne, welcome to our show. How are you today?
Thanks. I'm great. Thanks for having me on your show, Kevin. This is my favorite lookout point in Laguna Beach here. So I wanted to show everybody. See?
And yes, so this is Laguna Beach, California, overlooking that is the Pacific Ocean, correct?
Yes, it's the Pacific. Yep. That's downtown right there. And you can see the town and the blue ocean. And it's really a peaceful place to come up here. It's good for inner health, for the inside out fitness.
Well, and that's part of what your book is about. It's called Shrink. Could you tell us a little bit more about what is your book about and why is it that you wrote it?
Yeah, Shrink is about learning to be healthy and fit from the inside out. So it's about the psychological, emotional, and everything that has to happen inside in order to live a healthy, long, happy life naturally without feeling like you're trying so hard. So it is about, addresses a lot of different things that goes on in your mindset and your heart set, and then helps put together a personalized fitness plan so that you are doing what is best for you to stay healthy rather than imposing on yourself rules that diets, rules, programs, whatever that don't fit you that in the past have not worked. So it is more positively focused.
Oh, fantastic. You're a clinical psychologist, but you're writing a book in more of the health arena. What was the reason for that changeover?
Yeah, I'm a clinical psychologist and NLP master practitioner, and it is actually health is, people think of health as physical a lot, but psychological and mental health goes hand in hand with the physical. To have a healthy body, you have to have your healthy insides too. So it's not that we don't know what we need to do to live a healthy life. I think pretty much everybody knows that what it takes. But where everyone gets stuck is it's hard because things aren't aligned right inside. So that's why I decided to address it from a psychological point of view. Yeah, it hit number one bestseller on Amazon for a couple of days in three different categories. So I'm celebrating that with you. You're my first podcast after that. And
which three categories did you hit bestselling author in?
It was work-related health, injury prevention, and I believe it was energy healing, which I'm not sure how that happened, but it happened. But it makes sense.
And you beat some like Tim Ferriss, which is known for having books on bestseller lists for weeks, if not months on end.
Yeah. At one point it was higher than the 4-Hour Body, Tim Ferriss's 4-Hour Body, which is also a good book. Yeah, I'm pretty excited about getting my message out to people and helping people do what's best for them to live a healthy lifestyle.
And you say you also do speaking engagements?
Yep, like this.
Okay. So I know we talked about before the show, That's some of the motivation reasons you wrote the book is because other people in your that you've known or in your life had some serious and if not drastic issues that happened to them. Would you like to share a little bit about this for some of your motivation?
Yeah. The reason why I decided to start focusing on this is because if you really think about it, you can have everything in your life going well. You can have the best relationship and relationships. You can have extreme success. But if you don't have your health, then what do you really have? If you can't even get out of bed, or if you are not feeling well and can't even go play with your kids, or you don't have the energy to do what you really want to in your business, then the health is really at the core. And some things, some experiences that I've had with other people have also motivated me to focus in this area because it helped highlight how important it is. Do you want me to go through into that a little bit? Oh,
absolutely. Share some of that with you because as some of the listeners may know, and I know you know this, and I'd like for you to share some of the stories that we talked about before the show, is that at the time of this recording 5 weeks ago, I unknowingly... Yeah. I actually suffered from a stroke on my left side of my brain, which put me in the hospital for about 5 days. And, you know, it came from nowhere. I never expected it was going to happen. And then all of a sudden it just happened. Somebody that was like 34 years old, that something happened with them.
Mm-hmm. And it's nice to see you back and doing well now. So that was a great comeback.
Well, thank
I'm
you.
Glad you're doing well.
It was a traumatic experience. It's life opening.
Yeah.
Because I mean, you had talked about somebody that had a heart attack in their 30s.
Yeah.
I was talking with somebody else a few days ago, and she says that a bar that she goes to here in downtown Vegas, the bartender had a stroke and died at work in his 30s.
Oh my goodness.
In his late
30s. Wow.
So you just never know what it is. And, you know, if you keep putting your health off, it's just going to get worse and worse and worse. I mean, and until something dramatic happens, a heart attack, a stroke, or something else.
I mean, sometimes things happen with even two healthy people. So I'm not discounting that at all. But if there's a condition that we know about, or if we know what it takes to live healthy and we still aren't, then that's what I would like to, you know, focus on. So yeah, the thing that we were talking about earlier, I'll mention it again. So there was someone that I was very close to for 10 years, and he had a condition, but it was a condition that people live until they're very old having sometimes. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to die. It's just a condition that you live with and you manage, but it's also a lifestyle kind of a lifestyle thing as well. So he didn't take care of his health at all, and he would have said that as well. And unfortunately, when he was 34 years old, really young, he died of a heart attack, suddenly died of a heart attack. He had warning things before that, but it was devastating because if an accident happens, and that's also devastating. And one thing, but if you know that it could have been prevented by lifestyle changes, it's just very sad. And he had a lot to share with the world, a lot of talent, a lot of brilliance to share with the world, and wasn't able to share everything that he had. So that was extremely sad and really hit home for me. And then another experience I've had that had the opposite outcome is with my dad. My dad was diagnosed with multiple myeloma about 11 years ago, actually almost 12 years ago now. And when he was diagnosed, he was in really, really, really bad shape. And he was in the hospital for, I don't even know how many weeks, maybe 3 weeks, I don't know, a long time, and had an autologous bone marrow transplant. It was so severe, I think 6 of his vertebrae just crushed because of the bone marrow. It's a bone marrow cancer, systemic, and just really, really bad shape. But, and it was very scary for him, for us and everything. But he knew about what it took to live a healthy life. And he knew that there were some things he could do still that he wasn't doing. And he changed his lifestyle. And I think it's because he knew that if he did, like, this was it could be a matter of life or death. And I think it's easier to, for example, if you saw a car coming on the road, you would just jump out of the way so you wouldn't get hit. But if it's a really like lifestyle change where it, you know, every minute of every day counts, it's a little bit more challenging because you don't always think of how important it is. So anyway, back to the story about my dad, he was able to change immediately, and he changed everything, and he became a healthy vegan. He switched to alkaline water. He was very weak from being in the hospital, but even though it was hard for him, he made a point to walk outside every single day for 3 miles. He lives in Maryland, so it's cold there sometimes too, you know. But he did whatever it took, and he just changed everything he knew. He took the right supplements, and he, you know, he not only was he a vegan, but he became a healthy vegan, which is different than a vegan. We've talked about that a little bit before too. Not donuts, because donuts are vegan, but I mean like raw foods type of thing. And he is now thriving. 12 years later, he's doing well. And he is a really great example of just taking charge of your own life so that you have your life to do what you are meant to do in this world.
Yeah, and how old is he now?
Yeah. How is he? He's doing great right now. How old is he?
Yes.
Did you say 74?
74 years old
and thriving.
So at 63, he had this issue, and now at 74, he's probably in better shape than he was most of his adult life.
Yeah, I think he was 62, and I think he's going to turn 74 this year. Sorry.
I'm just doing the quick math. And these were the inspirations for you to start doing these things?
Yeah, those were a couple of them. I mean, there's so many other people I've known in my life as well. So just to, and we're all human. I mean, I'm human too. So, you know, it's helpful for all of us to do this and be able to thrive.
And I'm so glad that you're talking about that, because even with myself in mind, there's a lot of people don't make the big healthy decisions until something either dramatic happens to themselves or it happens to somebody that's close to them, because those are your eye-opening experiences. And for people that have, you know, read books like yourself that are kind of on the border, like, should I not, do I have the willpower to not go eat fast food again today? Doing that, it's like, hey, start making those small changes so that you can start having a healthier life. If it's being going raw or raw vegan or vegetarianism, or even still being a meat eater, because I'm still a meat eater myself, there are still healthy solutions with that. And I do see there has been over the last few years a huge draw of people going from meat eating to vegetarian, or even more profound, being vegan. But you're also absolutely right, because I just went to a conference this weekend. It was a health expo, but I went there to help a friend out. So I was just a bystander. And it was brought up that, because you made the distinction about this a few moments ago. You said there is a difference between a vegan and a healthy vegan. And the reason you're saying that is because, just because you're a vegan doesn't mean you're eating good foods. Yes, donuts can be one of the choices. I know Oreo cookies are vegan. And if you can fry French fries in and still be considered a vegan. So it does not mean that it's definitely healthier. So that regardless of your eating styles, just becoming much more aware of what you're eating, having books like Shrink out there where, you know, I'm assuming that works. You say that works in your mindset as well as start putting together exercise programs that people could.
So you're right. Like, why wait until it's too late? Why not realize this now when we are healthy and do what we need to do? And Shrink helps develop a personalized fitness plan. So I'm not advocating, necessarily advocating a vegan diet or getting up at 4:30 in the morning and exercising or doing any particular things, because I feel that we should all respect ourselves and we know deep down what's best for our own body. So for one person, like for example, for me, being vegan and doing yoga and might be just exactly what my mind and body needs. For another person, they might have other needs, you know, and it might go better with their personality too. So they might love working out with weights. They might love doing like real, like running or something like that. You just kind of have to get in touch with what's best for you, what you need, and not only what your body needs. It's a pretty in-depth process of figuring out yourself and knowing what your soul's deepest cravings are, and how you cope with stress, how your relationships matter, and what would ideally be best for you, like what an ideal day would be for you.
Okay. And you're right, because I know for myself, 2010, I lost a lot of weight. You didn't know me back then.
No.
So we didn't meet until like 2014 or 15. Yeah. Back in 2010, I have a photo of myself. It was taken on April 15th, 2010. And I was in that photo, I was approximately 240 pounds.
Oh. And I didn't know that.
No.
I didn't even know that till just now.
and I started doing a program called P90X back then.
Oh, yeah.
It was a very good at-home workout program.
I
was able to go from 240 to 180 in a little more than 3 months. After losing all the weight in 2011, I started doing hot yogas. And I still do a lot of yoga today. And that's my primary form of exercise. So I'm not going to the gym, you know, getting on the machines and stuff like that, because that's just not my preferred method of working out. That other people is great. Other people like CrossFitness. I mean, there's so many avenues out there. And depending on your physical ability, I mean, if you're 79 years old and you just started working out, you're probably not going to be doing all that much in weights. You might be doing something low impact, like swimming or walking or whatever.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Getting some kind of exercise plan out there is just to get your, what is it called? Getting the blood flowing. I mean, there's a physical fitness term.
I'm not sure what you mean, but I know the cardiovascular impact of it. Yeah.
Yeah. It's getting the cardiovascular part going. And that's good that you're sharing that with us, because I think too many of us get into bad habits, bad routines, and we do have to start at least doing at least one thing different just to start getting this escalating going.
Yes. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Hot yoga. Wow. That's tough stuff for me. That is sticking with it for the whole 90 minutes. That's admirable.
Well, if you're taking the Bikrams, and those are like 90 minutes, some of the other ones are 60 minutes. And 3 years ago, I had sciatica down my right leg. I could barely stand up for more than 2 or 3 minutes. And so I was doing what they call yin yoga, which is when you're in the classroom and you're doing a 60-minute class, but you're holding each pose for 3 to 5 minutes. So opens up the body parts, and almost 99% of it is on the floor. So you're going to be doing what they call a pigeon pose.
Opening up the hips and stuff. Yeah.
He's opening up hips and all the other joints. So there is something out there for everyone. And I purchased your book, Daphne. I have not read it yet. I got it on my tablet. So I won't.
Oh, cool.
You're just starting your launch. I said, okay, let me go and get the book. Just so I can.
Thank you.
I got your book, so I can help leave you feedback on Amazon.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. It's still on paperback and Kindle. And Kindle copy is pretty easy for people sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so for those of you out there, definitely go to Amazon.com and search for the word shrink. You might have to put down shrink Dr. Daphne Earhart, because I don't know. Shrink is only being one word.
Possibly.
A whole bunch of other ones. But I think you told me before that you also have a website.
Oh, yes. It might be easier just to go to insideoutfitness.com, and then immediately you'll see what you click on to get the book.
Right, because so I was
Inside Out,
website, and I went to InsideOut.com, and the first
InsideOutFitness.com
Inside Out Fitness. You're right.
Fitness.com.
Inside Out was a movie. InsideOutFitness.com, and right now the default page is your book, because I know because you're still going through the launch. All right.
Mm-hmm. So the end part of it. Yeah. So yeah, I think Inside Out is the movie, but InsideOutFitness.com is the website, and it makes it really easy for you to get it.
Okay. And now, is there anything that you would like to share with the audience? Cause I know you just got this book out. You got your doctorate. You got your master's practitioners. I did not know you're a master practitioner. I'm just a practitioner in NLP. But is there anything that you would like to, any kind of message that you would like to leave with the audience?
Oh dear, where do I start? There's a few of them. I would say if you want to start making a change, start with one thing today. Like, don't overwhelm yourself by imposing a whole new lifestyle on yourself. Just think about one thing that you would like to start doing, not something that you're going to deprive yourself of, but one thing that you want to add to your life. So it could be as simple as drinking water when you wake up in the morning. Just drinking a glass of pure water. Or it could be as simple as making sure you have at least 10 minutes of fresh air, walk outside in the fresh air every day. Something that you enjoy that's going to add to your health, or a fruit that you love, or something that you love. Make sure it's something that you want and that you love. And so just incorporate that for a week. Just do that for a whole week. Don't worry about changing anything else. Do everything else the same as you used to if you want to. Unless you feel like unless it motivates you to do more, but just add one thing at a time. And then the next week you could add a second thing. And just start watching what happens, and make sure that you're adding something positive rather than saying the change I'm going to make is to deprive myself of sweets. No, don't do that. Just say I'm going to add fruit, or I'm going to add an exercise that I like 3 times a week, or I'm going to add water or a bedtime ritual at a certain time or something like that. So I would say to just focus on one thing at a time.
And I'm glad you're saying that, because I'm going to paraphrase a quote. Is the journey of 1,000 miles begins with that first step. So it's just taking a step and then another step, and just look at it like we were saying, do those baby steps, do those initial changes. Don't go and say, you know what, I'm going to throw all my clothes out. I'm going to throw everything in my cupboards out. I just signed up to join a gym for the next 5 years, you know, 5-year contract. I mean, you can do that if you want to, if you're that committed, but you may say, hey, just tomorrow you live a mile from the store. Instead of, if you're going to go to the store, just walk it to the store. And walk.
Yeah, exactly.
Just do something a little bit different.
Something a little bit,
The second thing, and I'm sure Daphne will agree with this, is actually call somebody, talk to somebody, and have an accountability partner. Have that one person there, or do this new journey with one other person. I mean, it could be your husband or wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever. It doesn't really matter. But having that accountability is my
that's a good point. Having accountability and surrounding yourself in your life with people who are supportive of you, not only supportive of your new decision to make a healthy lifestyle for the rest of your life, but in general, have a healthy, start consciously making decisions of who you interact with and what kind of relationships you develop. It could, in addition to like the main relationships we often think of, you know, significant other or closest friends and stuff, there are other types of relationships that influence us a lot, like work relationships or people that we see very often that aren't necessarily part of our family or something like that. So just consciously being aware of who we interact with, and if they are a positive reinforcement in our lives or if not. And it doesn't mean you have to get rid of everybody, but just be aware of it and maybe consciously have the conscious conversations, be conscious of whether the conversations are going in a negative direction or if it's making you feel better afterwards. And if you can keep it positively focused with a particular person or not, just things like that.
Yeah, and that's very true, because you are the average of the five closest people.
Yeah, exactly. With.
That's going to be mental wise, my financial wise, education wise. I mean, that's in so many different arenas. Is to start, as Daphne was saying, be very conscious who you're associating with, because they influence you the most. So start hanging out with people that you would like to be more like, and that way you can be more like them.
So. Yeah.
Because that could mean deleting some of your friends. I'm doing finger quotes for those of you that are just listening.
Maybe deleting some quote of unquote friends.
From your Facebook or email or even phones.
So. You know what I do though on Facebook? Personally, if I see a post that really brings me down, I go to their page and I unfollow them. But I still remain friends, and I might go later and follow back, but. If there's something that's constantly negative, I unfollow, but I tend to remain friends because I want to be in a positive influence to other people, but I don't want it to be to the point where I'm brought down and not able to anymore.
And I see that a lot, especially like during the election or other things or other hot topics that are going on, and people mm-hmm. are very emotional or passionate about it. And like you said, I'm closed off to other side's opinions. Yeah. There's no reason to have that negativity in your life. And that's good. That's a good idea. Just unfollow them, because mm-hmm. maybe things that you're posting will actually influence them to make a change. So you don't have to unfriend them. You just unfollow mm-hmm. them.
Yeah. And I mean, I think free speech is great too. Like, people should be able to express their opinions and stuff. But if, for me personally, I can tell that it's mentally not emotionally not healthy for me, I will just not feel bad about unfollowing, because it's my life, you know, and one example.
Well, and also, I mean, some of those negative things could be somebody that's immediately in your life. And then you just have to weigh how important is that person to you at that point in time in your life.
Mm-hmm. That too.
Okay.
Good point.
Well, Daphne, it's been great having you on the show today. And congratulations again on the launch of your book. This is a very successful launch of your book. Congratulations.
Thanks, Kevin. Thank you so much for having me here. It's been great talking to you today and having you. Having all of you visit me here in Laguna.
And it's a beautiful view. So those of you that are on the audio, the video is also on the same link at kevinadunlap.com. Just search for Daphne Earhart for one of the shows, in case you might want to listen to the show, say 6 months from now, go and follow that. It is an absolutely amazing view. I must admit, out of the 40 some odd interviews I've done so far, you by far have the best background.
Well, I'm glad. I'm glad to bring some sunshine to everybody's life today.
Well, thank you. Thank you for sharing that. So for those of you, go to insightoutfitness.com. You can go ahead and download one of her books, or not download, you can purchase one of her books for other shows. Or if you are looking for any kind of coaching, go to kevinadunlap.com. That's my website. You can see all of my stuff on there. You can also actually order my book, Designing Your Own Destiny. It's two great books to have. You should have them both in your bookshelf. And anything else you want to say before we say goodbye?
Yeah, one more thing. At insightoutfitness.com, right now I have a free personalized fitness plan that you can download. So it's actually a whole chapter of my book that, if you just go to insightoutfitness.com, there'll be a place where you can enter to receive that mailed to your inbox. And if for some reason it doesn't work, please email me.
Yeah, and she does have a contact thing on her page as well. So you can email her directly as far as that is concerned. And that's great that you're giving away a free chapter of your book, that so they can read that. So, you know what, I do want to get this book, but at least they got a good taste of your book.
Yeah, free chapter. Yeah. Awesome. All right. Well, thank you so much for having me. Thanks for your time and attention.
Well, my pleasure. And everybody, have a wonderful afternoon or morning or evening, whenever you're listening to this. And it was great having you guys here. And goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye.
Thanks so much for listening to this episode of Life's Little Lessons with your host, author of Designing Your Own Destiny, Kevin A. Dunlap. For more great content and to stay up to date, visit kevinadunlap.com, facebook.com/kevinadunlap.author, and on Twitter @KevinADunlap. We'll catch you on the next episode of Life's Little Lessons.